Now, foundation scripture will be Mark chapter 11, verse 24. It reads like this.
God eagerly pursues us, and this is even in the Old Testament.
As we read, God says we're already healed. That applies to everybody.
You know, the scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12 states,
Hi, I'm Linda Gardner from Intoxicating Love Ministries. Let's open up with a prayer. Father God, thank you for everything that you have given us, and thank you for loving us enough to want us to learn more about who you are. I pray that you will fill my mouth with your words. I pray that you will open all of our spiritual ears to hear you, that you will open our spiritual eyes to see you. In Jesus' name, amen. When I was praying about what to talk about for this program, God said love. And I thought, really? Love? Everybody's talked about love. And the verse that came to mind when he told me that was Ecclesiastes 1, 9 through 10. What has been will be again. What has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. Is there anything of which one can say, look, this is something new? It was here already, long ago. It was here before our time. So yes, love was here before we existed, but God said, my children don't understand how much I love them. If they did, this world would be a different place. Those people who don't know me would want to know me, and those people that know me would want to know me better. So that's what I want you to talk about. And another verse that he gave me was 1 Corinthians 13:13. Three things will last forever: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. So love is something that we're going to learn about not only here on this earth, but it's something that we will continue to learn about in eternity. So it is something worth finding out more about. And lastly, God gave me the verse of 1 John 4:8. But anyone who does not love does not know God, for God is love. When we talk about love, we talk about it as a verb. We say it's an action. But God tells us that he is love. That's different. So it's a substance, and we don't understand that. We read those words over and over again, but we really don't understand what does he mean by that. So how do we know that God loves us? His word tells us that he loves us. And again, we've read these verses before, but we really need to understand them. And the verse that he gave me was Romans 8, 38 through 39. And I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love, neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow. Not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below. Indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. So when he says nothing, the Greek word for that means nothing. So we think that it's based on what we do or what we don't do. And that's simply not true. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what you have done in the past. It does not matter where you're at now. God still loves you. And if you don't believe that, you won't be able to be set free from what is keeping you in your prison, in your own personal prison. I want to give you an example of someone who finally had a chance to understand how much God loves them. We went to a confirmation retreat, and there were mentors that were there, and one of the mentors rededicated her life to Christ. And you might think that's odd. Why is she a mentor and maybe isn't that connected with Christ? Well, beloved, it happens all the time. People want to serve God. They serve him out of obedience, but they really don't know who he is. So she rededicated her life, and the Lord told me to tell her this very verse, that there is nothing that can separate her from the love of God. Well, we did an exercise that evening, and we wrote on a piece of paper what sins were still something that we struggled with. And we folded it up, we nailed it to a full-size cross, and then we carried the cross outside with our mentees. We carried it for a distance just to have a feel of what Christ did for us. And of course, we didn't suffer the pain and of being nailed to that cross and of suffering being whipped. But we were able to see what it felt like to carry a heavy cross. And after we did that, we got to the end of the area where we wanted to stop, and we put a flammable substance on all the sins that we struggled with, and we burned them off. And it was very liberating. And the Lord told me to tell her this verse, and she received it. And the next day, she didn't say anything to me that night, But the next day she said, do you know what I wrote on that piece of paper? And I said, no, I didn't see what you wrote. And she wrote, unforgivable sins. And God was telling her, there are none. There's only one sin in the Bible that the Lord tells us that is unforgivable, and that's blaspheming the Holy Spirit. And as long as you have a conscience, then you have not crossed the line in that area. And frankly, there are very few people that ever cross that line. So it doesn't matter what you've done in your past. God loves you anyway. He does not want to judge you or condemn you. In fact, when Jesus came, that's what he told people. I did not come here to judge or to condemn, but to give you freedom, to set you free. So don't get hung up on what you've done or what you haven't done. Just allow him to love you. God eagerly pursues us. And this is even in the Old Testament, Isaiah 30:18. So the Lord must wait for you to come to him so he can show you his love and compassion. For the Lord is a faithful God. Blessed are those who wait for his help. He waits for us to just call on him. It's really quite easy. You don't have to do anything. And some people may not trust that he really loves them, but he does. He loves you. How can God love me? I've done so many bad things. Well, he talks about that as well. In Titus 3:3-5, once we too were foolish and disobedient. We were misled and became slaves to many lusts and pleasures. Our lives were full of evil and envy, and we hated each other. But when God our Savior revealed in his kindness and love, he saved us, not because of the righteous things that we had done, but because of his mercy. He washed away our sins, giving us a new birth and a new life through the Holy Spirit. So there is hope. He does love us. And if you have never made that commitment to Jesus, to ask him into your life, it's easy. If you don't know for sure if he's real, just ask him that. Just say, Jesus, I want to believe that you are real. Please show me that you are. And he will. He delivers. He's just waiting for an invitation. But because God gave us free will, he doesn't force us to do anything. He wants us to choose him. Just like your children, if you have children, you don't want to make them love you. It's more precious and sweet when they do love you, when they come up to you running and they hug you and they kiss you. You don't want to force them. You don't want to tell them, you have to come over here and kiss me. That takes away what love is. So God waits. He waits for you to call upon him. So the first thing that you need to do is just admit that you're a sinner, and we all are. It doesn't matter how clean you've lived your life or what little you've done. If you've ever had a thought that is not of God, and for example, if you've ever told a lie, or if you've ever taken something, even if you didn't steal something from a store, maybe you just took a pen from work that you really liked, or maybe you spent some time on the computer instead while you were working instead of clocking out and doing it during your lunch hour, that is stealing from your employer. It doesn't have to be a big thing for you to be a sinner. Maybe you've had a lot of things in your life. Maybe you've had problems with addictions, or maybe you've had problems with sexual promiscuity. Then it's okay. God doesn't care. He loves you anyway. So I would ask that you just first mention that you are a sinner, and then acknowledge that Christ died for your sins and that he took them away for you. And the Bible tells us that when Jesus takes the sins away from us, he puts them as far from the east as from the west. That means you never have to ask for forgiveness again. And not only did he die for our sins, he died for our guilt and our shame. And that's something as humans that we like to hang on to. We hang on to that guilt and that shame, and we bring it up over and over and over again to God, asking him to forgive us. And he is frustrated because he already has, and he wants us to be free. He wants to set us free from that guilt and that shame. So once you've asked, it's been done. And for those of you who already have committed your life to Christ, God also wants you to know that there, yes, you may struggle with some areas in your life that are still not complete, maybe you're not living exactly how you think God would want you to. It's okay. You can also receive grace for that. It doesn't stop once you make the commitment. He will help you to be sanctified or to be transformed into the image of his son. It's not something that you can do personally, that you can work harder at, or something that you have to pay penance for. All you have to do is trust him that he loves you, he continues to love you, you will continue to sin, and that he will continue to forgive you as long as you sincerely ask. How can I receive God's love? 1 John 4:9 through 10 says, God showed how much he loved us by sending his one and only Son into the world so that we might have eternal life through him. This is real love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. So he loved us first, and we're not able to love ourselves or anybody else until we totally, really understand how much he loves us. In Song of Solomon, he talks about the bride of Christ, and that's who we are. And it doesn't matter if you are a male or a female, you are still part of the body of Christ or the bride of Christ. And it says in the Bible that in the Song of Solomon that we ravish his heart. When he looks at us, he sees the perfect son of Jesus when he looks in our eyes. He sees that we are perfect. It doesn't mean that we are perfect and that we've never sinned. But because Jesus died for our sins, when he looks at us, he sees us as perfection. The Bible tells us that we wear the righteousness of Christ. We are clothed in the righteousness of Christ. So how can we really truly understand how much God loves us? Well, one thing that I would suggest is reading God's Word. God's Word is truth. It is the promises that he has for us. And in this world where everything is so negative, it will help you stay focused on the truths of God and the freedom that he wants to give us. And I know when I first committed my life to Christ, I tried reading the Bible, and frankly, I thought it was boring and I really didn't understand it. But in all fairness, I read the old King James Version with the thee and the thou, and it just didn't make sense to me. So I would recommend going to a bookstore and just checking out a couple different versions. My favorite probably is the New Living Translation, because I think it speaks to me more in terms of how we would speak today. So I would recommend just paging through a few of the pages and see which one you're able to understand and get revelation from. And another thing that I did is I drive quite a distance to work every day, so I started listening to the Bible on CD. Actually, it was cassette tapes when I started 10 years ago. But that brought the word alive for me. And there is power in hearing the word out loud. Proverbs 18:21 says that the power of life and death lie in the tongue. So everything that we say either brings life or it brings death. So if we are speaking God's word, of course it's going to bring life. So when we hear it out loud, there's a power behind it that it supersedes just reading it. So I started listening to it on cassette. And God really spoke to me. He started to put his word into my heart. I'm not a person who's been very good at memorizing things. I always wanted to be part of the school production play, but I couldn't remember more than one line, so it wouldn't work. But when you listen to his word, it becomes part of your DNA. It becomes a part of who you are, and you find yourself being able to quote those scriptures without having to even think about it and starting to live them. And that's what God wants for us. He wants us to be able to live them. So I would recommend try reading your Bible every day, or try listening to it on CD and see how the Lord can speak to you and how he can transform your life. I started to understand who he was. I remember hearing some ladies talking about how he was the most important person in their life. And I knew that that's what I was supposed to have, but I didn't know him, and I didn't know how to make him number one in my life. So I started to pray about it, and I said, God, I know that you are supposed to be the most important person in my life. How do I do that? And as I read his word, I started to understand who he was. And when I started to pray to him, my prayers changed. I started to pray to him like I was talking to my best friend. And that helped so much. I got to understand, who is he? How does he love me? What does he expect of me? And how does he expect me to treat his other children? And it was amazing. It transformed my life. I couldn't wait to tell other people about how great God was. And that's what the gospel is. It means good news. It shouldn't be something that we stand in condemnation of other people and preach to them and judge them. It should be something that is exciting and fun and fresh and freeing. That's what attracts people to the love of God, not the negative things. So I started listening to the Bible every day, and I knew that he was changing me. At first, I loved ministering to people. I loved helping people. If somebody needed food, I would give them food. If somebody needed help because they were sick, I would help them. And that's where I would get my high out of life, was helping other people. But he started to change me so that I could go to him for my fulfillment, that he was my satisfaction, he was my joy. My prayer started changing. I used to spend maybe half an hour praying for other people, asking, you know, rehashing everything that person needed. And God kind of revealed to me, you know what, I already know what they need. You don't have to tell me. And I thought, you're right, I'm wasting my time telling you something that you already know. So I started worshiping him and praising him. Father, thank you for how amazing you are. Thank you how powerful you are. Thank you that you love me. And thank you that you love the people that are in my life. And as I changed my focus, I started to feel empowered by who he was, who my Father in heaven was. And I started to realize that when I interceded or prayed for someone else, I didn't need to rehash everything. So I just said, Father, you know what their needs are. And I pray that you will use me as a vessel, however you want me to respond, to show them your love. And that's what Jesus tells us in the Bible. He tells us that he only did what he heard the Father say, or he only said what he heard the Father say, and he only did what he saw the Father doing. And that's what the goal that he wants each one of us to do. And if we do that, we don't have to worry about making a mistake and having to apologize or to correct it later. And it's not easy. It's a lifestyle. It's something that you have to listen for his voice. You have to listen for it constantly and make adjustments as he speaks to us. An example of that is Abraham. When he was asked to sacrifice his son Isaac, he brought Isaac to the mountain. He was ready to sacrifice him, and just as he put his arm up to sacrifice him, God said, no, I have provided a sacrifice. Well, what would happen if Abraham was not listening for the word of God the second time? He would have continued in what God asked him to do the first time, and it would not have been the right thing. So sometimes I think that when we have a ministry that we are doing, we sometimes carry it forth a little bit longer than what God intended. Sometimes they're only meant for a season. So we need to listen for his voice. And when he says that's enough, I want you to do something else, he will bless us by moving us into a new direction. And that will be anointed by him, and it will have power, and it will have the glory that he wants to pour out on that particular ministry. So God's word is very important. I encourage you all to either listen or read it. And there's also a book that I would highly recommend. It's called Decree a Thing and It Shall Be Established. And it comes from Job 22:28. That's what that verse says. Decree a thing and it shall be established. So again, it's talking about speaking our words, how important our words are to speak out loud, because they do create either life or death. It's written by Patricia King. And if you want to order it, you can go online to xpmedia.com. It's not a very long book, but it has different decrees in it. And the one that I'm going to read to you is called Everlasting Love. And when you read it, it reads it as if you're saying it to yourself, but I'm going to read it so that I'm reading it to you. The Lord loves you with an everlasting love and has promised to give you a future and a hope. With loving kindness, he has drawn you unto himself. You look carefully and intently at the manner of love the Father has poured out upon you. It is through this love that he has called you to be his dear child. You are completely and fully accepted in him, your God and Savior. Nothing can separate you from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus your Lord. Not tribulations or distress, not persecutions, famine or nakedness, not peril, sword, angels, principalities, powers, death, nor life, neither things present nor things to come. Absolutely nothing can separate you from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus your Lord. God's love towards you is patient and kind. His love for you bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. His love will never fail. His love for you is so rich that he gave his only begotten Son. Because of this, you will never perish, but will have everlasting life with him. As a result of God's great love for you, you have an unbreakable, eternal covenant with him. Through this covenant of love, he has put his laws within your heart and has written his commandments upon your mind. You have been invited to the Lord's banqueting table, and his banner over you is love. His love is better than the choicest of wines. Through his intimate love, he draws and invites you to follow after him. You are fair and pleasant unto him. You are rooted and grounded in his love, and you will be able to comprehend with all believers what is the width and length and depth and height of his unfailing love. You have been called to know this rich love that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. You truly are the object of his deepest love and affection. And I think it's important that we read those words and believe them. And at the end of every chapter, there are many different chapters that she addresses, but I thought love was the one that we were talking about today, so I wanted to read that. She gives you the scriptural basis of where those verses come from, but she writes it in a way that it's as if the Father is speaking it to you directly. So it's very powerful. I would recommend getting that book. And it's all those words are in the Bible, and you can find them on your own, and I would encourage doing that, especially the first time. But it's handy to have them in one place, especially on a day that you feel discouraged, because it's easy to listen to the lies of Satan and the demons about that you are not worthy, that you are not a good mother, that you are not a good wife, or you're not a good husband. It's easy to listen to those lies. And God says, no, that is not true. You are precious to me. You are the person that I love. And again, it has nothing to do with what our actions are. It has everything to do with who he is and why he created us. And that is our purpose in life, is to worship him and to love him. And if you don't know how, ask him. Tell him. That was my prayer every day for quite a long time. I said, God, I want to love you more today than I did yesterday. And it worked. I learned to love him more. And then one day I even was bold enough to say, I want to love you as much as you love me. And then I started thinking, that's impossible. But then he reminded me of the verse that says, nothing is possible with me. Nothing is impossible with God. So I thought, all right, then that's what I'm going to ask for. And I found that as I learned to receive his love, I started to learn to love myself better. And I learned to let go of the things that I didn't do right. And yes, there are times that I still make mistakes. There are times that I still hurt people. But that's not my heart. That's not the heart that God gave me. So I trust in his ability to make things right, even if I screwed them up. In fact, Romans 8:28 says that he will make good of all things for those that he loves and that he has purpose for. Well, he loves and he has purpose for you. I can guarantee that. And it doesn't matter if you've ever taken that commitment and asked him to come into your life. He still loves you, he still pursues you, and he will pursue you till the day that you die. So know that he is patient, he is loving, he is kind, and he is waiting for you to come into his loving arms. He wants to heal you, and that's what his love does. It heals you from the past. It heals you from the hurts that you experienced. Whether it was something that someone did to you, if you have unforgiveness, if you are battling with the pain of the past because of addiction, or whatever you have done, God can heal you of that. He wants to set you free of that. He also has a destiny and a purpose for your life. His love will help you find what that destiny is, what that purpose is. And he will help you accomplish that with his love. I want to talk about a healing conference that I went to 6 years ago. It was the first time I went to a conference of that sort, and it was amazing. They prayed over my shoulder, which I had problems with for 18 years, and I was healed completely. I had no pain for the first time in 18 years. It was very exciting. And that, the very last night of the conference, when I was ready to go to bed, I was just thanking God for the healing and just for everything that I experienced in that conference. And I started to feel something physically, tangibly going through my body. I could feel it almost felt like electricity. And I felt that unconditional love that he talks about in the Bible. I could feel it physically in my body. And I can tell you that it was the most amazing feeling that I've ever felt in my life. It was better than any alcohol that you can drink, any drugs that you can take, or any pleasure that you can find in the things of the world. It was amazing. And that's why I called my love, my ministry, Intoxicating Love. Because that's what God's love is. Everything that he has to offer us is good for us. It doesn't hurt us. It's something that it's the joy that he wants to fill us with. It's the peace that he wants to fill us with. It's his love that he wants to fill us with. And there's a counterpart in the world that does not deliver. We think that it's pleasurable at the time, but it only brings us trouble and heartache and pain. And God says, I have the real thing. Come to me. Anyone who is thirsty, come to me. I will satisfy your thirst. Anyone that is hungry, come to me. I am the bread of life. He wants to be our pleasure. He wants to be our joy. And when we turn to him for that, it will be the real thing. And once you experience that, I can tell you, you will have no problem sharing that with someone else, because you will be so set free. You want everyone else to know that it's possible for them as well. So, who do you love? Who do you want to be set free? Start praying for them. Prayer is very powerful. You don't even have to preach to them. God will whisper in their ear. As they sleep at night, he whispers to each one of us. He wants us to hear his voice when he doesn't have to battle with the other things of this world. He wants us to be still and to know that he is God. He wants us to be still so that he can fill us with all the good things that he has for us. He has so many gifts for us that he wants to give. He just wants us to wait and hear for him, to hear his voice. So when you pray, it's a two-way thing. Pray, talk to him, and then wait, listen for him. And sometimes it might seem like it's 5 minutes and you're not feeling any impression at all. And when I say listen to him, I don't mean that you necessarily will hear his audible voice. Some people have, I haven't. But you start feeling that gentle nudging. That's his voice, and you've heard it before. And once you start recognizing it, you will know. The Bible says that my people, my sheep know my voice. We do know his voice. So listen, start journaling it. As he speaks to you, start writing it down. Ask him a question, wait for him to respond. It will change your life. He has so many things to tell you. He has so many truths to give you. Ask him for wisdom. He'll give you that in any circumstance. He'll give you wisdom, wisdom that is godly wisdom, wisdom that is beyond anything that you can imagine. He loves you. He loves you so much. That's what he wants you to know today. He would do anything for you. He already has. He sacrificed his son for you. He wants to set you free. Just receive that. Receive that gift. It's a free gift. It's the only time in life that you will be able to receive something that's free, that's true, and that will truly change your life. We love you, Jesus. We love everything that you have given us. I pray that you will give full revelation to each person of the fullness of the love that you have for them. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much for joining me today. I'm very excited about what God wants to tell you and wants to share with you, so I hope you will join me on the next program. You can reach me at Intoxicating Love Ministries, P.O. Box 525, McFarland, Wisconsin, 53558. We will see you next time.